Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
How's everybody tonight?
Yes.
It's a blessed and highly favored night. Man, I love the drink from the throne room. Love to get refreshed. Love the presence of God. Love it. Can't wait to go home. Woohoo! So many people are so excited about this life, they forgot what's coming. Glory. Psalm 103. Can we read this together, please? Speak it. Don't read it. You ready? Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Did you do that tonight?
Amen.
With all your soul and all that is within you. If you half step, then you get half step. Whatever you sow, you reap. You sow half, you get half. That's a bummer to get half a promise, ain't it? In fact, you probably won't get it at all. Because the devil comes and steals it then, because it ain't solid. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and all is within me. Bless his holy name. Verse 2. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget not all his benefits. These benefits are according to covenant. That means God Almighty made a promise to every single one of us. You know what happens? Most people don't believe. They truly don't believe. Or their belief system is not enough to activate the Word of God. The Word says faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word of God, right? Amen. One of the things what the Lord put on my heart tonight is the reality of covenant. You know, God can't lie. Thank God. Bless the Lord, all my soul, and forget not all his promises. He promises to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. He promises the gifts. All of these promises. See, but people don't get into the place of true belief, because when you believe, you receive. When you receive, you execute. Why? Because obedience is the key. He says, if you love me, you'll obey me. How many of y'all know that obedience is accepting what he says? People just think it's, well, I got to do what God's. Well, no, it's accepting what he says.
Amen.
He said, look at this. Verse 3, read it with me. Who forgives all of your iniquities. Wow, those are curses.
Amen.
He forgives them. Forgives all of our goofiness. Who what? Heals all your diseases through a miracle, through something. You know, your bodies are self-healing. I've been healed so many times, it's incredible. I've seen many people get healed. And then I've seen miracles in the process of healing. But see, you must believe it. You receive it. Then you execute it. Who heals all your diseases. He didn't say some of them. See, so many people think, oh, man, it ain't for me. It must be for somebody else. No, that's not true. It's for everyone. The problem is people just truly don't believe it.
Amen.
They believe it's for somebody else, but not for them. Look at else. Who redeems your life from destruction. Let me tell you, I'm a walking witness of that. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. Most people think that God's forgotten them. Just because he doesn't answer them when they want him to. But he really does. Even silence means no. Hallelujah. Look at it. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies. Who satisfies your mouth with what? Good things. So if it's bad things, you know that something ain't right. Why? Because the good things that are going to come out of your mouth is so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. How many of y'all need your youth renewed?
Amen.
Every day. Every day. So understand that these words are words of promise and covenant. What you hold in your hand is written promises from God the Father through Jesus the Christ, written by the Holy Spirit through the hands of a man. Is that powerful? God sent me and you a book of covenant. This is a book of covenant. And if you obey it, you will have long life and you will have prosper. You will prosper. Physically, spiritually, mentally, you will prosper. But if this book is not a covenant to you, if this is just a book of testimony, and don't get me wrong, there's nothing wrong with testimony, but it ought to be a book of covenant between you and God. And if you are a covenant keeper, everything in this written book, it's a written contract from God Almighty to mankind that's bound by covenant. This is a book of covenant. Everyone hold your Bible up. Everyone say, this is a book of covenant. The promises of God. It is a contract, agreement, undertaking, commitment, pledge, bond, and warranty. In Jesus' name. Oh, snap. It's amazing to me where people do not read the word. Why? You know, why? The enemy doesn't want you to know your covenant. He doesn't want you to know promises, pledges. These are from God Almighty. And don't be discouraged because it doesn't happen when you ask it right away. It's working on the other side. It's happening. You know, Jesus, you know, when Jesus was here, he is the Word. He spoke it, you know, it was done. He'd curse a tree, would die. For me and you, it may take 30 days. Amen? Exodus 34 and verse 1. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the Lord said to Moses, cut two tablets of stone like the first ones. Like the what? First ones. Why? Because he broke the first ones. Moses went up to take time with the Lord. The Lord told him, write a covenant. He was writing a contract between God and man. And he was giving it to Moses. He said, look at it, my people, because I want to expose their presence or influence of evil that they're associating with. He said, and in these commands, I want to write these on stone. I want to give them to you so you can tell my people and tell them if they will expose these things and not be influenced by these things and cut themselves loose from these things, they're going to have long life. And they will prosper. So this was prophetic because the first ones that Moses was coming down from the mount, he saw the Israelites worshiping a golden calf. Here he takes off for 40 days, comes back, and everybody's worshiping images again. He was so angry, he threw the tablets. If he could, he wanted to hit everyone. And they broke. But it was prophetic saying that that first covenant, there would be another one coming. Amen? So the Lord says, all right, go. The Lord says to Moses, cut two tablets of stone like the first one. See, the first ones, the Lord cut the stones. The second one, the Lord said, you cut them. And then the Lord said, I will write on these tablets the what? The words, these words of covenant, words of promise and pledge that were on the first tablets which you broke. So be ready in the morning and come up in the morning to Mount Sinai and present yourself to me there on the top of the mountain. And no man shall come up with you. Let no man be seen throughout all the mountain. Let neither flocks nor herds feed before the mountain. So he cut two tablets of stone like the first ones. Then Moses rose early in the morning and went up to Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him. And he took in his hand the two tablets of stone. Then the Lord descended in the cloud and spoke with him there and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed before him and proclaimed the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgressions and sin, by no means clearing the guilty, though, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the what? Third and fourth generation. In other words, that cycle until somebody finally breaks it. So Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth and worshiped. He did what? He worshiped. That's honor and respect. The greatest area that you can show God reverence is by worship. Then he said, if now I have found grace in your sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray, go among us, even though we are stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us as your inheritance. And he said, behold, I make a covenant. Before all your people, I will do marvels such as have not been done in the earth, in all the earth, nor in any nation. And all the people among whom you are shall see the work of the Lord, for it is an awesome thing that I will do with you. Why? God was making this covenant with him. He just told him right face to face, wait till you see what I'm about to do. Observe what I command you this day. Behold, I am driving out from before you the what? Amorite, the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And now these are all tribes of giants. Take heed to yourself, lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land where you are going, lest it be a snare in your midst. But you shall destroy their altars, break their sacred pillars, and cut down their wooden images. For you shall worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they play the harlot with their gods, and make sacrifice to their gods, and one of them invites you, and you eat of his sacrifice. And you take his daughters for your sons, and his daughters play the harlot with their gods, and make your sons play the harlot with their gods. You shall make no molded gods before you. Again, what did he say? Write my words that I'm going to give you on these tablets. Does everybody understand it? And again, he says, if you obey, it will bring life, prosperity, and protection. So God was warning them. Listen, that hasn't changed. This is not only a book of covenant, it is a book of rules. It is a book of laws. And Jeremiah 31. The promises of God are yes and amen. That's why the word says something powerful. It says, ask, seek, and knock. Many people ask and stop. That's why it never comes. Ask, seek, and knock. And what does it say? And the door will be open to you. Woohoo! The problem is they ask and stop. They're not willing to go through the fullness. They just stop. They come content with the things of the world, and they never get into that place because the door's not opening. Then they try to force their own doors, and the enemy is always on the other side of the doors that you force open. Amen? And Jeremiah 31 and verse 31. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their what? Their minds. And write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall any man teach his neighbor, every man his neighbor, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquities and their sin, and I will remember no more. So what is he saying? I'm going to put the laws in their minds, in their thoughts, in their soul. I will put it in, I'm going to write it in their hearts. The heart is the character of your spirit. No one will need to be taught because it will be translated and understood by the Holy Spirit to his people. See, when you are born again in the Spirit, the law is already put in you. You already know what's pleasing and displeasing. You already know what's clean and unclean. You already know what's righteous and unrighteous without even reading the Book of Covenant. You already know. When you are born again of the Spirit and filled with the Spirit of God, you already know. And the purpose that you already know is so that you go through the process of disconnecting so that you can get clean. Ezekiel, verse 23, verse 22, is everybody there? Yeah. Therefore say to the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not do this for your sake, O house of Israel, but for my holy name's sake, which you have profaned among the nations wherever you went. And I will sanctify my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. And the nations shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I am what? Hallowed in you before their eyes. In other words, where he is respected and honored in reverence. That means feared. When I am feared in you. For I will take you from among the nations and gather you out of all countries and bring you into your own land. Then I will sprinkle clean water on you and you shall be clean. I will cleanse you from all of your filthiness and from all of your idols. And I will give you a what? New heart, and put a new spirit within you. And I will take the heart of stone, representation of the law that was written on the stone, out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit, my Holy Spirit within you, and you will be empowered with the anointing. And it's going to cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. Then you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers. You shall be my people, and I will be your God. Wow. We'll get a new heart, a new spirit. Amen. And again, the heart of stone will be removed for the heart of flesh, which is moldable. And he will give us the Holy Spirit, so that we can walk in the new law of the Spirit of life. It will be the new law of the Spirit of life. Why? Because he's putting a whole new covenant. He's taking the old and putting a new. And that's what he has done. That's why Jesus came, was to bring a new covenant. And everything that was written about, can you imagine Moses? I mean, this is powerful. You got to think about this. Moses, who wrote the first four or five books of the Bible, got all of his information from God Almighty. He spent time and wrote, okay, what's next? Come on, he wrote Genesis. The Lord told Moses everything about what was going on and confirmed it by certain things that were passed down. But by the time it got to Moses' generation, there wasn't too many things being passed down, was there? So he was bringing, the Lord was explaining about a new covenant that he was going to bring. And it would not only be written in our hearts, but it would be written in a book of remembrance. So this book of remembrance, now there's another book of remembrance, and that's a remembrance of the things that people did. So nobody can say anything. But this is a book of covenant. He said, I'm going to bring a new covenant. And I'm going to give you my spirit so that what has been written will be confirmed. Because it says, two touch and agree, it shall come to pass. So when you're agreeing with what he wrote, that's two touching and agreeing. Does everybody get this? You don't have to wait to agree with somebody else. You agree with God Almighty. And it's done. Romans 8. Book of Covenant. Romans 8. So is the baptism of the Holy Spirit a promise to everyone? Yeah. Is healing a promise to everyone? Yeah. The Lord says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but he delivers them out of all of them. So he's always going to make a way of escape for us, no matter what. That's his promise. No matter what you're going through, he will make a way of escape. The whole thing is make sure that you're hearing God. Because the enemy comes like an angel of light to what? Deceive, to steal, to kill, and destroy. Romans 8, verse 1, would you read it with me? There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So he says, okay, you want to be a covenant keeper of mine. My covenant is in this book. This is a book of covenant. But you got to walk according to the Spirit, not according to the flesh, because then you're not a covenant-keeping person. Amen. He said, for the law of the Spirit of life, which is associated with the new covenant, in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned it in his own body. That the righteous requirement, everyone say righteous requirement. So is there a requirement? It's called righteous. Amen. The righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So everything is being fulfilled. You are maintaining covenant by walking in the Spirit, not in the flesh. And then all the promises of God are yes and amen. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh. Me, myself, and I. Lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. Setting your mind on things that are flesh make you disobedient to the covenant of God. But those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit, for to be carnally minded is what? Death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can it be. So then those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So the only way to please God is to be in the Spirit. And that's where you are denying yourself, picking up the sword, the cross. You are battling, because that is a requirement, because you can't follow without a battle. Amen? Oh, hallelujah. So the law of the Spirit is written in the book of covenant and in our hearts and minds. And by speaking the word of covenant, we are eating. Because what you speak is what you eat is what you become. Amen? So when you're speaking the promises of God, the covenant of God, it's being imparted in your spirit. It's getting burned in your memory. But the enemy wants to come and steal. So those who are not fully rooted, people that are not rooted, the enemy steals all the time. because they're planting their roots in other things of the world and selfish desires. So they're still being fed by the world. And you want to be disconnected from anything that tries to feed you from the world so that you're being fed only by the Spirit of God, which makes you separated from the world and sanctified unto the Lord. And as an extension of the covenant of His promise, you become a covenant keeper, and the promises of God are yes and amen to you. No matter what, you know it's coming to pass. You know it. 2 Corinthians 3. The book of covenant. Let's speak it. Do we begin again to commend ourselves, or do we need, as some others, epistles of commendation to you, or letters of commendation from you? You are our what? Epistle written in our hearts, known and read by all men. These are covenant-keeping individuals because they are quoting the covenant promises of God, not the commandments of men. Everybody got it? This is what God says. I don't care what man says. This is what God says. Verse 3, clearly you are an epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is of the heart. So the Holy Spirit, who wrote this book of covenant, is writing in you. Every time you speak it, you're eating it, and He's writing it in you. Now the enemy comes to try and erase it, or tries to get you to exchange the covenant promises for a lie. That's his job, and he does it well. Verse 4. For we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being sufficient from ourselves, but our sufficiency is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the what? The new covenant. So you are ministers of the new covenant, as long as you are covenant keepers. Amen. Not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit does what? Gives life. But if the ministry of death written and engraved on stones was glorious, so the children of Israel could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his countenance, which glory was what? Passing away. In other words, the old covenant was passing away. How will the ministry of the Spirit not be more glorious? So the ministry of the Spirit is actually the ministry of the breath. What you speak. For if the ministry of condemnation had glory, the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. It's called the ministry of what? Righteousness. Righteousness. For even what was made glorious had no glory in respect because of the glory that excels. For if what is passing away was glorious, what remains is what? Much more glorious. You are walking in a time of a glorious covenant, backed by eternity, backed by heaven, backed by angels, ready to move on everything that you speak out of this book of covenant, as long as you are upright, right standing with God. Is everybody okay? Woohoo! So in this, when you are into this place, you delight to do His will. Doing His will is not a struggle. There's not a fight about it. You delight to do it. In fact, you desire to do it. Lord, I want to do Your will. And you don't go, Lord, I want to do your will and go and do your own. You want to do His will, because you live to fulfill His purpose for you in this realm. That's what you live for. Amen? Amen. Philippians 2. Philippians 2 and verse 1. Therefore, if there's any consolation in Christ and any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy. Fulfill my joy by being what?
Like-minded.
How can you be like-minded if you're not in the Book of Covenant? Can't be. Having the same love, being of one accord and of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambitions or conceit, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. In other words, don't provoke, don't be conceited, don't become prideful, deny yourself in every area. Amen. Let each of you look out not only for your own interests, but also for the interests of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he what? He humbled himself and became what? Obedient. Let's say it again. He humbled himself and became obedient. Say it again. He humbled himself and became obedient. So can you become obedient with pride? No. The only way you can become obedient is with being humble. Amen. That's why the word says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and he will exalt you. Exalting you at due time means he will release his promise. See, the word says, after you do the will of God, then a promise is released. In other words, when God tells you to do something, when you fulfill it, he releases his covenant, his promise. But everything's on the contingent of you do, he releases. It's not on a contingent of he releases, then you do. That's not how it works. Has everybody got it? Many people think that. That's that entitlement thing. All right, God, you said this. He said, well, you ain't done this yet. You're not even in obedience. You're not in divine order. You're out of position. You're still touching unclean things, and you want me to bless you with this? Forget it. You'll end up bringing harm to yourself and others. Hello? And being found in the appearance of man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of what? Oh, snap. To the point of what? Death. Even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name. Why? Because Jesus was obedient to death. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of those in heaven and those on earth and those where? Under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Woo-hoo. See, we are the living epistles written by the Spirit of life. So we have ceased from the works of the flesh and the desires of the flesh. There is a reality that comes in and takes possession. And one of the things it takes possession of is the reality of who you are. See, it takes possession of you. And in taking the possession of you, your identity is established. I am a son or daughter of the Most High God. The I am takes possession of you. So that it's no longer you that live, but him that lives. Because now you're in a place of covenant. It's not a challenging of God. It's an area where he wants you to speak. Lord, your word says. Your word says. Your word says. He loves to hear his covenant. Do you understand that? He loves to hear his covenant. It reminds him like he doesn't need to be reminded. But in reminding God, it reminds us. Amen? Here is the reality that you're no longer your own. You're no longer your own anymore. You no longer have a life. Your life is in Christ. It is a new life. The life that you once had and lived, you don't want any part of anymore. Because you're under covenant. And you want to maintain covenant because you're in love with the covenant giver. Oh, glory. 1 Corinthians 6. in verse 15. 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 15. Let's speak it together. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them members of a harlot? Certainly not. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a harlot is one body with her? For the two, he says, become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. Flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body, but he who commits sexual immorality sins against his own body. Or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God. So you and I were bought with the death of the Son of God in the resurrection to a new life, a new covenant, and a new future, if you're a covenant keeper. Colossians 3. Book of Covenant. Hallelujah. Verse 3:12. Colossians chapter 3, verse 12. Let's speak it together. Therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you also must do. But above all these things, put on love, which is the bond of perfection, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. And whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to the Father through him. Does everybody understand? What does he say? Let the word of God dwell in you what? Richly. In other words, it's refreshed all the time. So whose responsibility is to refresh the word in you? Ours. Just because you read it once doesn't mean you got it. Just because you spoke it once doesn't mean you've got it. It must be constantly refreshed. Does everybody understand that? Constantly refreshed. And if you'll realize sometimes, man, you'll read something and you'll be going through, and next thing, you know, especially with teachings, man, you'll hear a teaching, then you hear it again. You go, oh, my God, I didn't realize I missed this much in it. Man, you can hear that same teaching 4 and 5 and 6 times over and over and over and find something new in it every time. Amen. Because it's being refreshed every single time. 1 Corinthians 2. Verse 6. Is everybody okay? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 6. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. However, we speak wisdom among those who are what? Mature. Yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age, who are coming to what? Nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages for whose glory? Our glory. Which none of the rulers of this age knew, for if they had known, they would have not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, eye has not seen nor ear heard nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who what? Love him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. How are you going to know them? Book of Covenant. By what the Spirit is revealing to you and the Book of Covenant. These things we also speak not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural mind does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. Why? Because he knows God's judging him at all the time. Amen? For who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. So what's happening is being refreshed all the time through the mind of the mind of Christ is the word of covenant. This is what is refreshing the mind of Christ in me and you all the time. So everybody got it? It is the word, the book of covenant, because the Holy Spirit is the covenant keeper. Glory. The mind of Christ, the book of covenant, the promises, the rules, the laws, everything's in here. It even have an employment section called Job. 2 John. Second John, in verse 4. Let's speak it, please. I rejoice greatly that I have... Is everybody there? I rejoice greatly that I have found some of your children walking in the truth. How are they walking in the truth? By eating the book of covenant. Amen? As we receive commandment from the Father, and now I plead with you, lady, not as though I wrote a new commandment to you, but that which we have from the beginning, that we love one another. This love that we walk according to his commandments, this is the commandment that as you have heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. For many deceivers have gone out into the world who do not confess Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh. This is the deceiver and an antichrist. Look to yourself that we do not lose those things we work for, but that we may receive a what? A full reward. Whoever transgresses and does not abide in the doctrine of Christ does not have God. Now that is powerful. If we're not abiding in the book of covenant of God, it says you don't have them. You know how many people call themselves believers and don't even read the word of God? They're lost. Why? Because they're living outside of the truth. Living outside of salvation's truth, aren't they? Because this is living inside of salvation's truth. But not being in this, you're living outside of salvation's truth. They're lost. So they're not abiding in the doctrine of Christ. Then does not have God. He who abides in the doctrine of Christ has both the Father and the Son. Does everybody... Now look, then he warns us, anyone comes to you and does not bring this doctrine, the book of covenant, do not receive him into your house nor greet him. For he who greets him shares in his evil deeds. That's powerful. Now, it doesn't mean, you know, you slam the door on somebody's face. Amen? I mean, when these Jehovah Witnesses and all these other Mormonites and whatever, false doctrines, false news. Those are false doctrines. They come to my house, man. I make sure that they leave with something. At least... try to catch them before they run. Titus 1. I chase some of them down the street, put something in their hand. Just pray in the spirit, they book. The only thing you see is the bottom of their feet. Let's pray. They're gone. But before you pray in the Spirit, just make sure you get something in their hand. Hallelujah. Titus. Is everybody Titus? Verse 1, chapter 1. Is everybody there? Let's speak it. Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect and the acknowledgement of the truth which accords with godliness, in hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised before time began, but has in due time manifested his word through preaching, which was committed to me according to the commandment of God, our Savior. So, he cannot lie. Everybody got it? He can't lie. He won't lie. He's not a liar. The devil's a liar. So when the Lord put this book of covenant together, he will fulfill it as long as you're fulfilling. But if you're not fulfilling, he don't fulfill. Amen? He's faithful when we're faithless. But he wants to get your faith up to a level where you're willing to receive or believe, receive, and execute. So there's an expectation, not a false expectation. There is a knowing. There is a knowing that what you ask, you receive. Why? Because you're in covenant. You're in position. And you're following the rules and regulations of the eternal kingdom that is pleasing God. Amen. You're not associated with sin. You're not associated with your own will. You've come to a reality that you're no longer living for you. And he's able to do far above all you could ever ask or think. That he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. That you're blessed of his spiritual blessings, seated in heavenly places, joined here of Christ, the righteousness of God, and armed and dangerous. Snap. Ephesians 4. Verse 11. And he himself gave some to be what? Apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers. For what? For what? Equipping, training of the saints for the work of what? Ministry. What ministry? The ministry of the Spirit. According to the new covenant, amen, in the book of covenant. For the edification of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith. Well, faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. So God wants to get us to a level of faith. And of the knowledge of the Son of God, which is also in the book of covenant. To a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, which is the anointing. That we should no longer be idiots. Dumb, misled, tossed, children, immature, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine and anything that anyone says. But knowing your book of covenant, nobody can deceive you, mislead you, or get you out of position or out of God's time. By the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love may what? Grow up in all things, and to him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body joined and knit together, by which every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes what? Growth of the body for the edifying of itself, where? In love. In love. You know, people, in other words, it's going to stop this foolishness. People get, people think about all these goofy stuff. It's time for the book of covenant to take possession of your total being in the arena that you become mature and maintain it. Again, there must be a refreshing, a constant refreshing. Amen? In Romans 6. Well, I'm too busy. You won't say that when you're eating dirt. Gosh, I wish I would have. If maybe I thought I would have. Hello? Why go into a place of regret? Just maintain and keep refreshing yourself in spirit and in truth. Amen? Then you won't reach that place of regret. Start confessing the word more instead of your emotions. Nobody's interested in how you feel anyways. Verse 12. Romans 6, verse 12. Let's speak it. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in its what? Lust. Do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Well, that ain't going to happen without the Book of Covenant. For sin shall not have dominion over you. For you are not under the law, but under what? Grace. And grace is what? God's plan. How are you going to know God's plan without the Book of Covenant? You're not. Oh, man. What then shall we? Is everybody there? Verse 15. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? Certainly not. Do you not know that whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or disobedience leading to what? Or obedience leading to what? Righteousness. Listen, you got to grab hold of something. You are a self-contained entity connected to God Almighty, an eternal being, not a temporary being anymore. You can't blame nobody for your reactions. You can't. But you don't know what somebody said to me. So what? You have dominion over everything. You have keys of authority. Look at, you can't get before God and say, well, you, Lord, but you look at what they ran me over. It don't matter. But Lord, what they said, it doesn't matter. God is looking at you. You're accountable for you. You should not be influenced by anything else but the Book of Covenant. Amen. Verse 17. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness and lawlessness leading to more lawlessness, so now present your members as slaves of righteousness for what? Holiness. For when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. What fruit did you have then in the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is what? Death. Death. But now, having been set free from sin, having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end, what? Everlasting life. See, this is how we overcome temptation. Remember, Jesus was the prime example. Every time he was tempted, what did he say? It is written. What was he using? The Book of Covenant. It is written. It is written. It is written. He didn't try to fight the devil in his thoughts. He didn't tell the devil, God's the one that sent me here. He fought him personally. It is a personal fight between you and the devil. So everybody got it. And you'll either have victory or you'll run. There's times of management, but management should only be for a short period of time. You're managing things until you get rid of them, because we should be driving them out. Amen. 1 John chapter 1. It is written. So when temptation comes to you, don't pick up the phone. pick up the sword. First John chapter 1. Is everybody okay?
Amen.
Are you getting this? First John chapter 1 and verse 1. Let's speak it. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled, concerning the what? Word of life. So Jesus is the covenant keeper. He's the covenant. He's the one that produced the covenant by shedding his own blood. In him is covenant. He is covenant. He was the sacrifice in the covenant to bring new covenant. Amen? So in it, he is called, this book of covenant is called the word of life. Why? Because if you obey this book of covenant, you will have life and prosperity and protection. The life was manifested, and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifest to us, that which we have seen and heard, we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things we write to you, that your joy may be what? Full. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we what? Lie. And do not practice the truth. You can't practice truth if you're not refreshing it all the time. Amen? But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. Why? Because the blood is what cleanses to restore covenant. When Adam and Eve were removed from the garden, they had themselves covered with fig leaves. The Lord removed the leaves and killed an animal right in front of them. Blood was shed and he covered them with the skins. Why? To restore covenant. Has everybody got it? Oh, glory. Is everybody okay? Again, verse 7. If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In other words, you got to be humble and repent. You got to be willing to expose it and be willing to accept the consequences. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar in his word is not in us, or his covenant. Has everybody got it? His covenant. See, people don't realize that they break covenant. 1 John chapter 5. In verse 18. Man, we are in a time where we've got to maintain covenant. And we've got to be able to maintain in the arena of the book of covenant. We've got to know the book of covenant. In verse 18, is everybody there? We know that whoever is born of God does not sin, but he who has been born of God keeps himself, and the wicked one does not touch him. How is he going to keep himself? Through what? The book of covenant. We know that we are of God and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. And we know that the Son of God has come and has given us an understanding that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true, in his Son Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. How are you going to keep yourselves from idols? By what? Spending time in the book of covenant. Amen. Isaiah 61. We're going to close here. But I'm going to read Isaiah 61 to you from the Amplified Bible. Because it's amplified. So just follow along in your Bible as I speak this. Is everybody okay? Praise God. Glory. In verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me. It's upon us. Because the Lord has anointed and commissioned us to bring good news to the humble and the afflicted. He has sent us to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted and to proclaim release from the confinement and condemnation to the physical and spiritual captives and freedom to the prisoners. To proclaim the favorable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance and the retribution of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion the following, to give them a turban instead of a dust on their heads and a sign of mourning, the oil of joy instead of mourning, the garment of expressive of praise instead of disheartened spirit. So they will be called the trees of righteousness, strong and magnificent, distinguished for integrity and justice and right standing with God, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. Then they will rebuild the ancient ruins. They will raise up and restore the former desolations. They will renew the ruined cities, the desolations, deserted settlements of many generations. Strangers will stand and feed your flock, and foreigners will be your farmers and your vine dressers. But you shall be called the priests of the Lord. People will speak of you as the ministers of our God. You will eat the wealth of the nations, and you will boast of their riches. Instead of your former shame, you will have double portion. Instead of humiliation, your people will shout out for joy over their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double what they had fortified. Everlasting joy will be theirs. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery with a burnt offering. I will faithfully reward them. I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their offspring will be known among the nations, their descendants among the peoples. All who see them in their prosperity will recognize and acknowledge them, that they are people whom the Lord have blessed. Can you believe it? Can you accept it? Now will you execute it? This is the promised covenant of God Almighty to me and you, written out of the book of covenant. What an awesome thing. But again, as a place of position, it's a place of upstanding, right standing with God. It's a place where it's no longer your life and you acknowledge it. I no longer live for me anymore. I live for him. Why? Because you live to be a covenant keeper under the covenant, the book of covenant. And his promises, again, I say, are yes and amen. Do not be discouraged because it doesn't happen today. But know it's being worked in the unseen realm for it to manifest. Amen? Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word of covenant. We thank you for the promises. We thank you that we delight to do your will. We thank you for changing our hearts and for refreshing us with your word of covenant, word of life, word of promise. We thank you for your healing words, for your words of salvation, for your words of wisdom and knowledge and understanding. We thank you that your word will not return void. We thank you that we are your sons and daughters, sealed, bought, sanctified, justified, and glorified for your purpose as covenant keepers. And we promise, Dad, to give you all the glory in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.